Since 1991, Pro Taper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8-inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, Pro Taper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit ProTaper.com for more. Everyone, welcome to the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper. Once again, Chase Curtis and I are in the Swapmoto Live office. And
alone.
Huh?
Alone.
Alone, yeah. A-Ray's in Poundtown, Kentucky, and Michael's at home. And, yeah, we had a big weekend.
Yeah. Most importantly, Ezra is at the feed store, so it's quiet today.
At the feed store with Mom. Nice. That's awesome.
Alex, have they revoked your California license yet?
No, not yet. What do you mean, California license? I still have a Tennessee driver's license.
Oh, okay.
Attaboy. Well, attaboy.
Yeah, we don't play that. Yeah, we're East Coast, you know, all day.
Yeah. But yeah, we had a big weekend, obviously. Anton was at Unadilla. Not Unadilla, Bud's Creek. Did you go, A-Ray?
No, I did not. I will be going to Ironman this weekend, though. It's only a couple-hour drive from where I'm at right now. So, yeah, I plan on going there, you know, mingling around, and, you know, I'm just seeing some friends and stuff. I've been kind of going stir-crazy a little bit, not being at the races. So, it'll be good to be back there this weekend, for sure.
Yeah. So, Chase and I had kind of a hellish trip to Tallahassee, Alabama for the Mini Major East. We'll get to that later, but it's a wonder that we're here in California doing this podcast, because American Airlines wanted to bring us home on Wednesday.
Yeah, I can't believe we actually are here.
Yeah. But anyhow, big racing action this weekend, Anton, and big fumbles from the scoring personnel.
Oh yeah, it's like a weekly thing at this point. Yep. And like, part of it that I've been thinking, I'm like, okay, is this an internet issue? Is this like an infrastructure issue? Is this just like, what is it at this point?
Yeah.
You know? We've said it enough this year where it doesn't seem like this has been, you know, as great as this year has been, the coverage and just like the technical aspect of it has been very lacking. Mm-hmm. And for the timing thing to happen again the way it did, for the 450 motos to be kind of wonky the way they were, yeah, Barcia got disqualified, and I'm sure that threw a wrench into some stuff. But even like the broadcast too, it's just like, dude, mm-hmm. I hate to like be so negative, but it's pretty tough right now. I could see why a lot of people are as mad as they are, because like every week it just feels like, oh, another one.
Yep.
Okay.
It's ridiculous at this point. I had friends texting me. Obviously, we were at the track, but I had friends texting me in the morning saying, asking if I knew what was going on, because they thought I was at the race, because they went to click on Flow, and it took them to quad racing. Oh. Butch Creek was quad racing. So I don't know what went on there, but yeah, it's pretty ridiculous at this point.
Yeah, and then there was a point during the day when we were on our way home from the track at Mini Major, and I went on Instagram, and Anton, I saw that you had posted the Motocross of Nations stuff. And I was like, sick, but I didn't see anything after that. So I was like, oh, well, I'll grab photos and I'll do the post. And so I went to the AMA website, and I did a post and said, top three, here we go. And then later on, it was gone. I'm all, why did it disappear? I guess that's why it disappeared, eh? Were there, like, comments saying you guys are knuckleheads?
Yes, lots of comments that we were dumb. We were, and a couple text messages like, hey, you guys know? And I was just like, oh, wow. Because someone had brought it up to my attention, some guy in, like, a Suzuki pit shirt. Someone's dad, I guess, when we were doing How Was Your Weekend interviews under the AMA trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And I walked into the AMA truck just to ask, you know, like real politely, like, hey, do you guys know if there's an issue or are you working on something else? Because, like, I just saw, I know Eli didn't do that.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah, we're working on another one. And then, yeah, dude, it's so weird. It's because it makes everything a hiccup, you know, and even at the races, like, as someone that's there, I know for people that aren't at the races and that they don't understand, but, like, it's just like us going to do any 9-to-5 job. So, like, there are times that the Wi-Fi doesn't work. There's times that other stuff doesn't, you know, happen the way that it should, and it just bogs the whole day down. mm-hmm. to where, like, you get to the end of it where it's like, oh, shit, I still need to do XYZ things that I can't do because I can't even get, like, a text message just sent out here.
Yeah.
You know? And, like, part of that is always going to be when we race in the middle of, you know, rule settings. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, too, it's just like, oh, my gosh, it's just so frustrating because, like, there's a standard that we want to be at and we just can't even get to it.
Yeah. Alex, do you know what happened? I posted AMA results that Eli was first and Sexton was third. And who got second according to that?
I think Anderson was was in second place initially. Yeah,
so we did a post and it was all wrong.
No, I didn't see any of that. I watched the race live just with I don't know, I was at my chick's house and they have like the Map TV on DirecTV. So I watched every race live. I didn't really have any issue. I didn't look at live timing or anything like that, but yeah, I mean we did have some good racing. That's all I know. I was excited to see Dungey up there. I mean, the 250 class was exciting. I just thought this year has just been very, very good racing this outdoor season. Super close. I mean, damage control with Chase in the first moto, and then, you know, Eli even in the second moto being, you know, him talking and, you know, to Anton talking about, like, being a bit flat. And, it's crazy. Is it to me, Anton, like you interviewing these guys, I'm watching like your the little post race things on YouTube.
How was your weekend by OGO?
Yes. How was your weekend by OGO? Are these guys being more truthful this year? Like I feel like you got guys like RJ, even Dungey, Eli, all of these guys, they're being super like truthful with their answers and they're giving us more than they have in years past.
Yeah, I don't know. I agree. And I'm like, and we've joked about it so many times. Like, some of us used to dread doing how was your weekend when it was like dudes like RV that you would have to talk to that would just be so salty. And so it sucked. And now it's fun. It's a lot of fun. I really, really look forward to it. And I don't know. I agree with you that some of the stuff that guys are saying is just so there. You know, there's other stuff that they're coy about, or maybe I don't know the full thing on, and I'll ask, like, hoping, like, oh, okay, I hope that this, like, gets them to come out with it all the way. You know, last week when I'm asking AP about his testing, you know, he did a very good job to say that he had changed something, but he never said what they had changed on those forks, that they're just, you know, air forks,
mm-hmm. yeah.
straight off of anybody else's bike.
Yeah.
So there is a lot of more truthful stuff to it. A lot of guys that are just like, hey, this is the stress and this is what it is to race this many races and this is where I'm at this point in my season. But then they're also very coy and very guarded when it comes to certain stuff, especially if it's a bike thing. Like, oh yeah, we changed something, we did this, we did that. There are certain guys that'll come out and say, like, we changed this, I slowed it down, I sped it up. But it just, I agree with you, it does feel like everybody's really open right now.
It feels like people are, because they're bringing the riders to the press area,
mm-hmm.
and it's a media corral to interview guys. It feels like they know that they have to be there. And I think Anton's getting better interviews from the guys that are in the corral than if we were like bogarting in their semis after the race.
Right.
Hey, let's do a how was your weekend real quick.
Yeah.
You know, I never had a problem just walking into shit and asking people to do it. And sometimes they'd say no and I'd walk away and go get someone else. But, you know, when you're in the media corral, you know you're supposed to give an interview.
Yeah, you're prepared. Yeah.
Yeah. But totally. But I think Michael does a good job of getting candid answers from the guys.
And I think this year too, we're seeing a lot of people unhappy with their setup this year, a lot of frustration. And so I think, in previous years, people maybe want to make excuses when they're not doing so hot. And now they're trying to like, hey, I'm not actually just making excuses. I'm trying to provide some reason as to why I'm not happy and what's going on, right?
Yeah, people are being more candid about their dissatisfaction with their bikes.
Yeah. Totally.
Before.
Yeah.
But Anton, you almost got poor Alex Martin to cry again.
Yeah. And I'm not trying for that. I very much dread Fox Raceway. I really dread
We should bring some tissues.
Mm.
Oh, we'll cry again. Yeah.
We'll do the cry guy. The cry guy
cry
Snapchat.
Emoji? No, let's get like a box of, the square box of tissues.
Yeah,
We'll wrap it black with Swapmoto Live lightning bolts. And we'll give
put
it
the
to
mic in there.
Yeah. Because I like how you have that little clip-on mic, and sometimes they put it out with a lightning bolt on the front.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. So I agree with what you said too, Don, about people coming over to the media corral, because when they come over there, you know, it's just assembly line. They'll get me, they'll get LeBig, they'll do Mathis, they'll do Racer X, like bang, 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 they knock them all out. I'm sure, A-Ray, especially from your perspective as a rider, when you've thought about your race happening like that and you've had time to think about it, you know, sometimes even when the results aren't there, you have an idea of what you did in your head, and then to spit it out that way real quick, knock it all out in 15 minutes and then go on instead of all of us being over there, because there's so much stuff that has to happen at the end of the day at the race. You have team people trying to talk to you, the fans that are there trying to close your locker up and get out of there. You know, I really do like the media corral deal. It's cool that they put that on, and especially because now we see the need for it, because, you know, I think we had talked about it earlier in the year. There was a little bit of hemming and hawing on doing how was your weekend in the pits at Supercross races again, and we weren't almost going to be allowed to do it. And it's like, no, you have to have this. You have to have this. You have to have this with racers, because otherwise you lose all of that stuff. Like the PR quotes that come out, nothing against anybody doing the PR quotes, but nobody sees them. Only so few people see them. These things get hundreds of thousands of impressions. They, you know, get way, way more out there. And if we're going to try to sell, especially this next generation of guys, like, to have them on camera being as candid as they are, being as forthcoming, it's awesome to have, and I hope it helps out a lot going forward.
The only thing that kind of stinks is that everyone has interviews now. Like, before, we created How Was Your Weekend, people didn't always used to do that, you know? So, I don't know. I just think we used to do it better than everybody else, but now everybody's kind of level playing field. We still do it better because Anton asks more questions, but it makes people cry. So, hey, any word on Dungey? Is he coming back next year, or is this a one and done?
I think they're still trying to figure a lot of that out. He looks good. You know, Ryan is getting better and better, even to see in that second moto where it was him and Ken right up there, right off the rip. I was excited to see that. It's getting good. I don't think he's going to do Supercross. No. You know, I don't see that happening at all. But it would be cool to see him keep doing the Nationals. I think that's something that he needs to figure out in these next few weeks. And then what KTM needs to figure out, because there's a lot of moving pieces just within that team.
Yeah.
You know, as we get to the end of the year, now we're starting to really see the silly season stuff hash out. And the orange guys are going to be very interesting to watch going into next year. You know, second year on the bike, more people, Supercross-only contracts with Marvin, Tom Vial coming in, Cooper coming back, AP figuring it out. It'll be interesting to see what they do over there.
Why do you think Dungey would not do Supercross?
I mean, I would think that it's maybe just like the risk factor, you know? Like, I mean, all of the outdoor stuff comes natural to these racers, right? Because they did it from such a young age. Supercross, it's a little bit different. Like, it's pretty, like, I mean, Supercross is gnarly. I mean, you have whoops, you have triples, ruts, and I don't know, like, big jumps. And I just think that he's I don't know, I feel like this is like a last two raw grassroots tour. I don't know, but I did see in an interview that he did want to race next year. It's just, you know, the politics of it, you know, like whether or not it's right for him, you know, or whatever they come up with, I think, with the team. So I mean, I think it would be great to see him back outdoors again. But I don't think it would be anything during Supercross.
Yeah, not to discredit him at all or anything, but he's not half-assing his program, right? But he's not going to Alden's. He's riding at home, right? Mm-hmm. And I think if he were to sign up for Supercross too, I mean, you kind of got to go to Alden's, ride Supercross during the week, be back on that program. And I mean, I think he's been open too about saying, hey, the wife's maybe not the happiest about this, but he's doing it on kind of her terms and terms they agreed on, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, if I were her, I'd probably be pissed too. I mean, he made a jillion dollars. Like, why does he still want to go out there, suffer, and get rocks in his face, you know, for 30 plus two twice on a Saturday? Hell, that could be their date night. If I had that option, I probably wouldn't be out there either.
Yeah.
To that point that you said, Chase, about having to go down to Florida, yeah, dude. I mean, think about when he's going to have to put in, or go to California. Think about when they're going to have to put in all of their Supercross time.
Yeah.
It's when it's cold in Minnesota that he's not going to be able to do that.
Yeah.
This is like the perfect summer gig for Dungey. You know, like, go out, you start doing motos when the weather breaks and the track's all up north, and just kind of keep getting into it. The kids aren't in school or anything like that yet, so they get to go have fun. But you know what? I'll say this. It's been really, really fun to see Ryan go through all of this. And Troy, his dad, is there. You know, Jade's there working for AP. I've had fun watching Ryan, and I think, too, like, he needed this year more than anything just to come back and be like, hey, could I still do this? I think there was a lot of unanswered questions with him. We all know how many times he's tried to come back in the last five years.
Yeah.
This is the perfect send-off.
Is he satisfied with what he's doing, though? Like, I mean, I know everyone thought he was going to be winning halfway through the season, or is he going to win Millville, or... But, I mean, he hasn't hit a podium yet. Is this enough for him? Or also on the flip side, like, will he be better next year?
Personally, I think he wants more. I think he's happy, but I think he wants more. And I think that's kind of a reason where he's thinking about coming back next year, too, to maybe start riding a month before than what he did this year and try and come in next year even stronger. He knows he needs to work on his intensity. He's not really riding with a lot of guys during the week. So I think he's content, but I don't think he's thrilled.
Do you guys think that he, I mean, while these guys are racing Supercross, he's testing and helped develop the race bike, like, better? Because it's no secret that they're having issues with the new bike, right? Do you think that they're going to want to come out swinging with a better bike, obviously, next year? I mean, and Dungey might be that guy to help them bridge that gap while everyone else is focused on Supercross.
Yeah.
Good, yeah.
You know what's funny is to hear him really, really unhappy about the bike when he came out at Fox Raceway and was like, yeah, this is the best outdoor bike I've ever ridden.
But that's the thing we've heard about. That's like the infamous quote we've heard about this new bike. I mean, think about all the preseason hype before Supercross. Everyone absolutely loved the bike.
The best bike.
Everyone's like, this is the best bike. This is the best I've been. And then all of a sudden when racing happens, they're not happy again. So I'm still very confused about what's going on with this new machine, because I talked to one guy and it's engine issues. I talked to another guy, it's chassis, and then another guy, oh, it's just the fork. Like, it can't be all of those things, right? So I think they just need more time.
And I think too, to that point about Ryan and testing in this bike, you know, Don, especially when we've been around Ryan so much when he was competing at the highest level and championship chasing, Ryan knows he can get lost in the setup thing, and they're always searching for the perfect bike. And I was really interested to see how he would handle that this year, seeing how much of a challenge it was that the bike wasn't already worked out. It wasn't something that he had been helping test and develop already. It was more like, here you go, we're going to build from this rather than build around you. I think he's done pretty well in that too, because it'd be very easy for him to get, you know, spun out on a lot of things and this go even worse than it has been. Not that it's gone bad, but it could very easily, like, oh man, he's testing way too much and it's not working anymore.
Yeah.
Hey, on the other side of the fence with the Husky guys, Malcolm did a lot better this weekend.
He did.
Did he look considerably better? Anton? Do we lose Anton?
Are you there?
Oh, there we go.
There you are.
Yeah, it faded in and out. Okay. Yeah, Malcolm looked good. Dean looked good. I think that everybody kind of knew, you know, how hard is Unadilla? How hard is that one to get back to? And then to what Malcolm's point was when he was telling you last week, Don, they're going to get to the hot conditions, and it was Florida hot in Maryland. Mm-hmm. So that favored him. You know, it was everybody. That's all you could talk about was how hot it was on Saturday.
Were the trash cans out in full effect?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Even at like 8 o'clock in the morning, you would just be standing there looking at each other and be like, how you feeling? And then you would just see everybody just start breaking out in sweat, just drenched. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Even Malcolm, like, he fell victim to the results thing. Cause on his Instagram, he wrote, yo, got 10th, pumped me in the top 10. And then Christian comments, yo, dude, you got 9th. He goes, oh, I leveled up.
That's funny.
But, yeah, that's badass. Malcolm in his second national back gets 9th.
Yeah. It's pretty cool.
Roger must have been man-friending like crazy.
What do you think he did? Like, imagine him sprinting from the booth to make sure James is okay and then back to the Rockstar Husky rig.
Yeah, I don't know.
Split in half.
Did you see Roger Larson this weekend?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I saw Roger. He was back and forth everywhere. I didn't get to see James, though. I was bummed about that.
I seen a picture of James on Instagram, obviously the one that they posted with Wygant.
Super fit looking,
James,
huh?
Like, he's thin. Like, all that weight that he had gained, like, it's gone.
Yeah. Is he on that program now?
What?
The infamous program?
No. Optavia?
The West Coast Aldens.
No.
taking California by storm.
No. Yeah, he looked good. What did you guys think of him in the booth? Have you got a chance to watch the race yet, Michael?
Yeah, I think it was decent. It wasn't bad. He had a lot of great points. I think that, I don't know, in my opinion, I don't know if the racers think the same way that him and RC and Chad think. Mm-hmm. So, like, whenever he's explaining stuff, he would obviously explain it to, like, how he would think. But they were pretty gnarly takes, I would think, right? So, mm-hmm. I don't know if it was like it wasn't bad takes, but it was his opinion, I feel like, versus what the actual rider might have been thinking.
Mm-hmm. You know what got kind of rubbed me the wrong way? He kept saying,
"Uh-oh."
He kept saying Joe Shimoda,
Far East,
the Far East Coast. Man, all right, say it once. I don't know. Maybe I'm sensitive. Everybody's sensitive now, right?
I guess.
Huh? Yeah, stop Asian hate.
I don't think you have any right to be sensitive.
I don't.
No, I liked it. I enjoyed it. I was pretty... When I watched it, I got back to the hotel, and I was pretty tired. So everything was kind of funny to me at that point, mm-hmm. but
he kept calling Dungey RD5 coffee.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wonder what he would say about A-Ray if he commentated a Supercross.
I don't know. I liked when he gave Bogle a bunch of love, though.
Yeah, he kept talking about Bogle.
Yeah.
Bogle wasn't even out there.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
Yeah, did you catch that, A-Ray? He talked about Bogle like 4 times.
Yeah. I guess like whenever he did that scrub or something, let his leg off over the Henry Hill right there. Yeah. He said something about Bogle with that leg swag or something like that.
Yeah.
Do you think Mitch said anything to Joe about that? Or Nick?
I don't know.
Told him not to do it?
Well, I mean, it was pretty dirty for the mid-race.
Yeah.
Like, that was maybe like a...
Well, Joe's, discovered taking his leg off this year. He's been doing it everywhere.
Yeah, but even the scrub, like, the angle he was at and everything, it was nasty. I wonder if he meant to go that hard. Because he's thrown a couple good ones while we've been filming before and pulled up next to me, like, I did not mean to do it that big.
Yeah. So, Anderson, second win with a 2-2.
Yeah.
Was he satisfied with that, Michael? Like, getting the overall with consistency rather than a moto win?
Yeah. And I haven't gotten the chance to rewatch everything yet. But especially in that second moto, some of the stuff Jason was doing as the track, shaped up and formed, it got drier, more ruts developed, more braking bumps developed. Like, again, as much as it dried out, Jason got super creative and was, like, writing up on all the off-cameras that were there, finding, like, really good lines. He just seemed like he had a good time flowing everywhere around the track. It never really seemed like he was caught up in all of that other stuff. And, I mean, the freight train of guys that were behind him, Chase, as hard as Chase was trying to go to get in the front and break away from all of them, Jason was just right there doing his thing. And there were times that he would, like, leave the guys behind him. There were times that he would... catch up on Chase. Yeah, Jason looked really, really good on Saturday.
On the TV, he looked...
He's been good at that track before. You know, that track seems to be one that would favor him quite well.
Yeah, on the broadcast, I mean, I think that's the best he's looked all year. Even, was it Hangtown he won?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, even more so than that.
It's cool to see that he won a race this late in the season when he's already, out of title contention and out of MXON because of an injury or something, right?
Right.
He was jumping, one of these, singles into the turn over one of these it was, the anthill, and then it had a single after it on the inside, and he was jumping, the anthill over the single and then pivoting his bike and just going around the corner. It was a huge commitment, and I think, he just does great stuff like that on the bike, and I think, a lot of people are going to say that this one was sort of given to him. He might have gotten lucky with the issues that Eli and Chase had, but I mean, you got to be there. You got to be consistent with these two motos. So I think he rode great.
Okay, so 1 point, 2 races left.
Dude,
this is so gnarly.
It's just like
this is the closest it's been in a long time, right?
Right. Like, so, just, I mean, after first moto, everyone's hope is probably like, oh, well, there's a series.
Yeah.
And then it just, boom, there we go. So,
Two races, Ironman and Fox Raceway. Mm-hmm. We know Chase super good at Fox. Where do you guys see this going?
I don't know. I've been thinking about it a lot, too. Both guys seem pretty good. They don't seem, like, rattled by it or anything. Even Eli's comments, like, you know, if I had never been in this position before, I'd probably be, like, pretty freaked out by the pressure. I'd be shaking from it. See how confident he is and just ready to get this done because he knows this is it. Even in the press conference, somebody said, hey, look at how much fun you're having. Look at all these things. Like, are you going to consider maybe coming back for next year? And he's just like, yeah, maybe I'll think about that after Paula. So he's just trying to get this thing handled. Chase, you know, for the issues that he had, took that one really, really well and just is ready for it. And you could just feel, like, even though it's 1 point, it's the same thing that it was after Unadilla, the pressure feels like 10 times more now, especially going into these last two. Eli made a comment, you know, you never know what the weather is going to be at Ironman because it's like every other year that it rains, like a torrential downpour there. That doesn't seem to be the case this week. It's supposed to be pretty dry but nice and like in the 80s. Mm-hmm. So should be a perfect weekend come Indiana. Yeah. And if they prep it well, that'll be interesting to see. Again, and, you know, this was like another race in a row where it was a really dry, hard base there. And I wonder what they're going to do at Indiana because that just sends everybody for a loop. They come in thinking one thing and then they have to start adjusting off of what it ends up being in reality.
Yeah. And not to count, I mean, don't count out Fox either, speaking of weather, because we've been having some interesting, like, weird weather out here the last month or so, and I think there's some, like, possible monsoon storms coming in a couple weeks, so if that comes a little earlier, or and if that's as accurate as it says it's going to be, that could be interesting.
Or it could just be ass hot.
Yeah, it's going to be ass hot, probably. It'll be humid for California, for sure.
Terrible. So, I don't know, man. All right. My take is Chase is super fast, super talented, wants it.
Yeah.
You know, you can't describe in words how bad he wants it, right? But then look at Eli. Look at the ability to dig deep and just go into that beast mode he has.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Like, if I had to go bet, I'd bet blue.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I would bet red, but I thought of this last night. What happens if they tie?
Goes to overall wins.
Wins, right?
Mm-hmm. Then
what if they tie wins?
Moto wins, probably.
Okay.
Who's got more wins?
That'd be bizarre.
Eli's got more wins, doesn't he?
I would think so, because he had that streak.
Eli's
got
a lot.
Yeah.
All right. A-Rate, Michael, what do you guys think?
I'm honestly, like, I'm gonna lean red. I think that Chase could go 2-1, 1-2. He could tie it up this weekend, and if he does that, then I think it's his. He can go 1-1. I mean, that's a 6-point swing at Fox. So mm-hmm. I'm on the red train.
Yep. What about you, Anton?
Dude, I'm right now completely 50-50 on how it's gonna go. I really don't know, and you look at it because you really want to see Eli do it. You know, the turnout that fans have had once they figured out, like, yo, this is really Eli's last year to come see him outdoors. He's really happy. He's having a lot of fun. You always want to see a guy go out on top like that.
Mm-hmm.
But for Chase, and you know how, like, sports-minded Chase is, he wants to beat the best guy. Like, he's progressively gotten better over the years, and he really sees this as, like, I could beat one of the best of all time on my first real chance of doing it. Like, that's going to put me where I need to be. So Chase wants to do it too. Both are super cool stories. I'm sure after this weekend, I'll have a better idea, mm-hmm. but like I am purely, and I know that's such a bad outlook, but I'm straight 50-50 on it because they're all ripping. Like Chase is super happy at Honda to see Lars and see Brandon and everyone around him. They all seem like they're just moving forward on the right path. They have that bike and especially that shock right now figured out super, super well. Same thing goes over for Eli at Star. You know, he's got Gilly there helping with the suspension. Jelly working on the bike. Everybody on the team all gets along. He's staying there again. Like, everybody's in the right mode. There doesn't really seem to be anything holding anyone back. It's just on.
Right.
Chase, to your point, as we were talking about, like, who's got what as far as the year goes, I mean, it's looking at the stats, it's so incredibly close. Mm-hmm. They're both so fast. Like, Eli's average qualifying is 2.3. Chase's is 2.8. You know, Eli's got 128 laps led. Chase has 111. The wow. average finish, Chase is 2.0. Eli's 2.1. But then Eli has the 11 moto wins and 4 overall wins to Chase's 7 moto wins and his 3 overall wins.
Wow.
And it still comes down to 1 point. And you're just like, wow, dude, look at just how this year has played out and just look where they are.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Like, when is the last time that we had a championship that's gone down to the wire like this? I mean, yeah,
They said it on the broadcast. It was like Langston and
Hughes.
Frick, I forget. They said it on the broadcast, though. They mentioned it. It was the last time the championship has been that close this late in the series.
Yeah.
What was it, like 2007? If it was going to be Langston?
It was like early 2000s.
Someone got hurt, like before the last round or something. And then, I think it was shortly after that is when GL had his eye thing, right?
Right, mm-hmm. right. Yep.
Yeah.
Dude, let's just hope for no crashes or injuries. Like, it's going to be so insane if they race head-to-head the last four motos of the year. Like, no one crashed. Like, when Chase crashed twice in that first moto. Like, if it's just heads up, these two guys.
Can we just get them to race with no one else on the track? Like, just just them two? Man.
Get guys in the middle.
Crazy.
But, yeah. Awesome 450 action. Let's take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, and we'll talk about the little bikes.
Racetech is the world's largest aftermarket motorcycle suspension modification company with over 35 years experience personalizing your suspension setups. Racetech Gold Valves provide a plush feel with drastically improved bottoming resistance and increased traction.
Hey everyone, Don Moetta here. Over the past 20 years, I've built a ton of cool motocross project bikes. When it comes to choosing a great wheel set, my first call is always to the crew at WUSA. Importers and distributors of Talon, Kite, Hahn, and Edge hubs, the wheel building team at W is unrivaled when it comes to lacing them up to DID or Excel rims. Let's be honest now. Next, cleaning air filters or changing oil. Tightening spokes is one of the most tedious jobs when it comes to working on your bike. When it comes to wheel sets from W, though, you know that they'll stay straight and true, and the spokes will almost always stay tight. There's a reason that factory teams and top riders everywhere rely on W. When it comes to anything wheel-related, your one-stop shop is WUSA.com. Check them out.
Hey, this is Colt Nichols of the Monster Energy Star Racing Yamaha team, and I rely on Guiltless Food Co. to keep me fueled properly, feeling 100%, and is super convenient. It's healthy food that doesn't suck. Sign up at guiltlessfoodcode.com.
Out here, on the edge, failure is no option. Here, you don't compromise. Off-road, on-road, on the track, off the grid. Sunstar sprockets and brake discs come installed in more motorcycles and all-terrain vehicles than any other in the world. Period. The engineers who design your bike trust and spec Sunstar for the same reason you should. Because here, on the edge, failure is no option. Sunstar, number one in sprockets and brake discs.
What's up? This is Christian Craig. As a motocross racer, being in top physical shape is a must, and my favorite way to train is cycling. And whether it's road biking or mountain biking, I rely on Roy Cyclery to keep my bikes in perfect running order.
Roy Cyclery has been servicing Old Town Upland, California since 1962. Mention the Swapmoto Live podcast for additional discounts in the shop.
Hey guys, it's Ryan Villapoto. Now that I'm living the retired life and not bound to factory team sponsors, I'm able to choose my partners when it comes to building my bikes. I choose Backyard Designs to create my motorcycle graphics because they do a great job. Their kits look great, go on easy, and last long.
Backyard Design has the most comprehensive and user-friendly graphic website in the sport. Use the discount code SWATMOTO at checkout for a discount at backyarddesignsusa.com.
G'day guys, this is 9-times X Games gold medalist Jared McNeil. Off the motocross bike, I spend plenty of time cross-training on my intense mountain bike. From the super fast and efficient Sniper cross-country bike to the aggressive Primer and Tracer trail bikes, or even the amazing Taser e-bike. Every intense is designed and developed in the United States and built to the highest standards. A life on two wheels certainly includes pedals too, so give the crew at IntenseCycles.com a look.
Everyone, welcome back to the Kickstart Podcast, presented by Pro Taper. Touching back on some 450 rumors then. Hey, when we were at Starbucks, we saw Rodbell in California.
Yeah.
What was that about, eh, Ray?
I don't know. I might have heard that he might be riding Suzuki for the last two rounds. For some reason, like he's in California, which is weird because like all the weeks leading up to this week, he's been in an attic, doing HVAC, and then I've seen him doing floors during the week, and then he's racing on the weekends. So it's weird to see him in California this week. So
yeah, initially I thought maybe he was testing with Enzo because he paid to have his forks done.
Maybe
he's running conversion forks.
Maybe there's a Suzuki semi that needs some new AC done out here or something this week.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm assuming that he might be riding out there in California, so maybe you guys. Yeah,
maybe we'll see
him up. Yeah, because I know Marshall Walton posted this morning that he's hurt.
Poor guy.
So, speaking of HEP, like what? I've heard that they're not on yellow next year. There's two options.
Yep.
What's the word, Mike Antonovich?
Yeah. It kind of goes back to, I think we talked about it last week with the Rocky Mountain team and the
right.
Rides Unlimited group that was going to get the KTM support not happening. So then it seems like that support could now float over to HEP or Cowie, which, Cowie has talked for years about how they need to have more 450s on the track instead of just the one or two that they have with the factory team. But they could get involved in that too. You know, four pipes. Justin does a really good job.
Yeah.
Justin's got a lot of non-endemic sponsors that are on there. The activations that he does,
yeah.
They get a lot of really, really good feedback. And I think that's cool for him. Suzuki and Wheeler and what they've given him over these last years has been a great thing because he's really made great effort with the support that he has. And I think that if someone from a big factory gave them a little bit more bikes, budgets, and more R&D so they weren't trying to reinvent the wheel themselves so much, you could really see things go well. And I mean, things are lining up for them. World Supercross, is coming. They have the team set up for that. They're already making the money off of that because the first round of payments have hit from the organizers. So, like, stuff's going forward. They have 250 guys lined up to grow the team. I think it's pretty cool. It's good to see a team like that after sticking it out and even taking the risk to get more of the Suzuki support that was out there after JGR went away.
Mm-hmm.
Dustin really had to work to get that. It would suck to see them leave, after that, but he's earned any kind of support out there that would be a bump up.
Might we see the team on a different bike before World Supercross or for World Supercross?
I don't know, because it seems like the World Supercross thing has been pretty happy that they were on Suzuki, because then it brought like more manufacturers in.
Right.
And like, who knows, because they have a lot of stuff. This is coming really, really quick. Even for a guy like Dean, who's probably supposed to race Motocross the Nations on a Husky, I would imagine, to have to jump in 2 weeks, be on a Honda to ride for the team he's going to ride for.
Yeah,
I don't think that a lot of people are going to have the chance to make big sweeping changes like that. Or the guys that do make them, they're going to be playing catch up in those, couple events that they have.
Yeah. Along the lines with AGP too, and with the Rocky Mountain deal going south, I imagine Colt's probably trying to rekindle his relationship with maybe the HEP guys, because I know they were in talks prior. So that's a possibility, right, for the 450 class?
We lost him again. Yeah, no, of course. And then what does this do to Bogle? Does Bogle retire now, or does he?
It's true.
I had heard Bogle is going to do like World Supercross stuff too, so it doesn't seem like we've seen the last of Justin, but that might be on an orange bike. So, maybe if they do change equipment, this could bring him back in, because I think he had reached his threshold on that yellow bike.
Yeah.
Yeah.
HEP going green or orange? I mean, I would like to see him go green, because we have so many orange teams, right?
Do we?
Or through the years, there have been so many sport teams, but there's never been a secondary, just the PRMX guys.
What color does Twisted T look best on? It's going to look funky either way.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'll give Dustin credit. You know, I rode for that team in 2019. It's very well ran. You know, with Dustin, he busts his ass, you know, to find sponsors and he makes the calls and, you know, does a lot of different things, I think, outside of, you know, the main, you know, like, hey, we're just going to have, like, we're trying to get outside sponsors. We're trying to get outside sponsors. Mm-hmm. He's one of the ones who actually had. So I think, yeah, I think what he's doing is it's really good. He didn't grow too soon. I think he took the proper steps, and now he has a great team, I think. So, yeah. Props to him. Mm-hmm.
I also heard a rumor that Bar-X might be switching manufacturers as well. Ari, do you have any insight on that with Mumphy?
I do not know. I have been way outside of the loop in Kentucky. I haven't talked to Carson or anybody, but yeah, I mean, it's crazy to think too, because they've done so much with that Suzuki 250. They've had a lot of R&D, and those things are not slow.
No, yeah.
That'd be so weird if there's not a Suzuki. If there's
not a single one, yeah. God, it'd be weird.
Does Dylan Woodcock race a Suzuki when he comes over?
I don't know. He's racing one right now, though, right?
Yeah. I don't know. Man, that'd be strange. Hey, on the World Supercross note, Anton, has it been announced what team Kenny is riding on?
What was that, Don? Who's on what team?
On the World Supercross. Like, have they announced what team Kenny is racing for?
They haven't, like, come out and said anything official yet, but, I mean, the word is out there of who's doing what. It seems like Savacci and McElrath are going to do Rick Ware. Mm-hmm. So, one guy on one brand of bike, one guy on the other. Shane's going to be on that Yamaha, and it seems like Joey's going to be on a Cowie, mm-hmm. From what I heard this week. So, you know, as we've mentioned so many times, with the limited shipping stuff that they're going to send out, like, pretty gutsy of those guys, but cool that Rick Ware is going to take on that challenge, because that was something that the SX Global dudes were really hoping that someone would take the chance to field two different bikes and appeal to two different sponsors and two different riders and everything. With Phil not going to race because of his broken arm, I think a lot of people thought, like, oh yeah, Shane's just going to stay there. But I'd heard that Cade is going to do Supercross for Club MX for World Supercross. So that's good for him.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's all kind of coming together. There's little bits of stuff here and there that are coming out. You know, the big one, though, is still trying to figure out where Ken's going to go. Like, mm-hmm. What are they going to do with that? Is he going to be on a Honda? Is he not? I think, you know, still hasn't signed the contract yet for his contract extension at Honda. And mm-hmm. as every weekend goes, I think people are more like, well, what's going to happen here or what's going to happen there?
Yeah.
And, you know, even with Buds, I think that was a big factor of how last weekend went, of where he would go or what the mood would be between them. He looked great, you know, so right when Kenny needs a good result, he puts it down and he does it. So yeah, we'll see. It's an interesting time. I think everything's going to get hyped up here in the next few weeks. Tracks, TV broadcasting stuff that's going to get announced. I would expect a lot of news from them pretty soon. Mm-hmm. They did announce the last team recently, the 10th team. So it's Livia Lancelot's team. They're not going to do the MXGP World Championship anymore. They're only going to do World Supercross.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Livia Lancelot. You know who she is?
Nope. No idea.
French. She's raced women's motocross.
Okay.
Cowie. She was super fast. Anyway, getting back to Bud's Creek. Joe Schmo.
Jojo.
Joe goes, did he go 3-1 for second overall?
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, I thought that was awesome. Yeah. He's kind of becoming one of the dudes.
Totally.
Second out. Well, he didn't win.
Right.
But Moto win. People seem to go nuts for him. What do you think the appeal there is, guys? Why do people like Joe Shimoda?
His attitude. How can you not? Yeah. I don't think I've met a single person that doesn't like Joe. Like, you talk to everyone that supports him, everyone at Fox, everyone at Monster, mm-hmm. everyone at Bell. They all love Joe, right? Like, it's just, I don't think he's ever had a bad experience with anyone.
Yeah.
I think he's just one of those personalities. You got to put, the more you put him in front of the camera, the more people like it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Far East Coast.
No, but it's seriously though, it's badass for him because these last weeks, if you start to wonder like what if he had been riding like this at the beginning of the season, how much different this championship would look, right? I mean, mm-hmm. he's jumped into second place in the points, I believe now, because Hunter's had a couple of struggles, but yeah, I mean, it's just bravo to him, bravo to Nick Way. Mm-hmm. Yeah, whatever they're doing,
yeah,
is really working.
I think Nick's made a big difference in his program.
Yeah, totally.
Anton.
Nick's a full corner man. Mm-hmm. Dude, yeah. Nick is like, it's like watching a boxer go. He came over after Joe got off the track in the first moto, had the ice bag right on his shoulders to cool him down. Yeah, Nick's about it.
Yeah. So I know that there was bad starts and such, but is Jet Lawrence in championship mode? What do you guys think? He went 2-3?
I think it's... let me look at how close it is. I mean, he's definitely going to get it.
Yeah.
You know, there's no doubt about that. Yeah, he 433 to 396 on Joe. So
oh, wow.
It could happen this week. Yeah,
yeah.
It could.
Yeah.
But, I mean, is
On that Jet thing, he took a gamble that first moto, I think, on that inside gate.
Yep. He got lucky, too, because at first, like, off that initial jump, I didn't think he was... It wasn't looking great, but he snuck around the inside of that corner and cut pretty well. I think he was like fourth or fifth off the start, but that was for sure a gamble.
Yeah, I don't know. But, I mean, is he hanging it out right now? Is he just doing what he needs to do?
I don't know. It's hard to tell.
I think so, a little bit. You know, because there were times that he wasn't going to push it unnecessarily this weekend, and especially in that second moto, where Varese went down and he just narrowly avoided the bike there. Yeah. And then after him and Mosman had that back and forth earlier, and then you see him go down and then, you know, to ride around that, Jet did a really good job of avoiding the potential catastrophes that are laid out right in front of him a couple different times this week. I have to wonder if he's starting to think like, oh man, I'm almost done with this 250 deal.
Yeah.
Cause nobody's asked him that. I started thinking that today, you know, only four races left, and then he changes everything. I wonder how that's going to be. But yeah,
have you heard about his, like, I had heard that he was riding the 450 during the week, too, the last couple weeks.
I know he was riding on one down in Florida for a little bit.
Yeah.
And, I mean, we all saw the Red footage Bud? And all of that. Yeah.
Who do you guys think likes who the most, or dislikes who the most? Do you think Mosman and Jet or Barcia and Ferrandis?
I don't know. Jet has hated Mosman for a while,
right?
And he's like said some things about it, like,
mm-hmm.
"Hey, could going back to Jet real quick? Could he wrap up the title at Ironman?"
Yeah,
I think so.
Yeah,
I think so.
So if he does that, what are the odds he shows up to Paula on a 450 to help Chase?
That's a great thought, actually.
Wow.
Yeah, I was literally just thinking about that. Do you think that they're like, hey, like let's throw a wrench in this, like
I could see Honda doing that.
Like, screw it. Even if Hunter has third locked down, you know, like, hey, put him on a 452, have four 450 guys hit Paula.
Yeah. Yeah.
Help out there, yeah. Just so they could get the freaking both titles and sweep, you know, 250 and 450 outdoors.
Well, it would make perfect sense for Jet to get on it.
Yeah.
Get a race under his belt on a 450.
I think Honda's been known, too, especially the last couple of years, to do interesting things. I mean, last year they were talking about the last two rounds had them Jet not been in the situation he was. They were talking about throwing the guys on the brand new Honda for the last two rounds, right? So, yeah, maybe.
Maybe they'd bring Harry up off the injury list.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So
are we going to talk about the Barcia thing?
We have to touch on it.
I sent Anton before we started the podcast. I sent him the video that Barcia posted. I mean, I don't know how I feel about it, right? Like,
yeah.
It's a touchy subject for both sides. For one, it's like Barcia freaking, you know, cleaned his ass out like bad. But at the same time, like, if you see it from Barcia's view, Ferrandis like cut over on him and then he had nowhere to go over that single, so he did pop over that thing.
It's too narrow of a field of view too.
Yeah, and if you see Barcia make it through all of that carnage, you know, like he jumps over that freaking yellow thing and he's in the turn, if you're Dylan, you got to chop the throttle and let him like go by and pass him somewhere else, right? Like, it's Barcia, you're not going to get around him on the outside. He'll just, you know, he'll clean you out.
Right.
So, like, I see both sides to it. I see why Dylan's pissed. I see why Barcia's pissed. But if I'm Dylan, I'm not making that pass right there.
Yeah. But had Dylan checked up, Barcia would have been making a pass going off track, right? Because Dylan had him for that split moment, and then Barcia went off the track.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I don't know.
Yeah,
I mean, do you think if Ferrandis isn't there, is Barcia going off track, like going straight because he couldn't stop? Like, I mean, maybe Dylan just was his berm that he needed to stay on the track.
Is there any history between those two? Like,
a little bit.
From what?
Yeah, a little bit.
I can't think.
And I mean, I saw Dylan. So, like, I was at the bottom of the next hill. So I saw Dylan ride around and just completely ride off the side of the track. And I saw his visor pointed up and he was all dirty. And I'm like, oh, that sucks. Like, he crashed, you know? I mean, that's a bummer that he went down. Especially for him to be coming back like that, and was completely oblivious to, like, the incident that had happened to that. And mm-hmm. then to hear just all of the everything that has gone on, and, like, yeah, Justin definitely does have a reputation just solely off this year's three really big incidents with guys that, you know, we all know about. So, yeah, I'm kind of on A-Ray's point, like, devil's advocate. He did get bumped off the track, but then, like, and that would be a lot to jump off the track, just miss the banner, just miss the yellow block, be on, like, the grass, not lock up the brakes and all that, but then to hit Dylan, it's just like, yeah, dude, you know that's going to happen. Like, the same thing when Jason got taken down by him at Indy, it's like,
yeah,
you know Barcia's going to do that. Like,
right.
you can't do that. That's what's going to go down every single time.
Yeah.
And especially because that was a really good, from the GoPro perspective of the front number plate, pretty good pass by Dylan. Like, you got to give him that. And Justin doesn't take it very well when someone gets a real crafty move. Like, mm-hmm. the best way for him to retaliate to it is just to chop
smash.
And that's what he got, you know?
Yeah, I'm watching it right now. I will say that those yellow things, they don't just move. They're not styrofoam. No, like,
oh, the SpongeBob's?
You'll crash your brains out if you land on one of those, right?
Yeah.
So, and I've ridden there. It's a little bit of a blind jump. I've actually crashed right there in that next section. It's very easy to fade outside because it's all those turns are off camber. So
yep.
It's very easy to fade to the outside on those turns. So, like, I mean, to me, it looks a little bit like a blind, like, roller. So, it seems like Dylan comes over on him at the last minute. He has nowhere to go. And at the same time, he has to, like, the last minute, give it a little bit of gas to change direction to not hit that yellow thing. So, I mean, it started out as a racing incident, and it ended up as, hey, like, I'm going to fucking clean your ass out.
Yeah.
You know, Ari, for what you said in the off-camber before that, where they're going right leading up to that hump, that GoPro, like, they're not that horizon leveling and all of that, and the shadow, you're not going to see how tricky all of that is. You're not going to see the ruts and the holes and the bumps that are there. That's a really, really tricky spot of the track. Me and Mike Emery were just standing there watching the 250 race just, like, maybe 20 minutes before all of this went down and saw how tricky that was through there, and yeah, it's kind of like a perfect little breeding ground for contact incidents like that, because everybody knows that's a really good place to make passes. And then if you can clean them and then get down that flyaway jump, you're gone. You can just break away, and there's nothing they're going to be able to do to retaliate.
Yeah, that damn turn's like a damn landslide. So it's hard to even get around that corner to begin with. And then, you know, like, yeah, and to get pushed a little bit wide there, I think it's a little bit of a blind jump. And then afterwards you have that big yellow barrier. I think he might have just gave it a blip of throttle that last second right there. I mean, yeah, he went off track, but it's not like he was trying to cut the track. He had reason, you know what I mean? It's not like, hey, I'm just gonna go across the track and clean you out. Not like he had no intentions at first trying to cut the track, because mm-hmm. like, you know, when Ferrandis put out that first post and he's like, oh, a rider cut the track, jumped into me and cleaned me out, that's not really how it went, I don't think.
Yeah.
That's a little over-exaggerated.
I agree with that.
And to be honest, I don't think that Ferrandis knew that Barcia had a camera on his, you know, front of the bike.
And he wasn't on Barcia's bike. He didn't know what went on. He just saw Barcia come from off the side of the track right into him, right? So he was ahead of him at that point.
So I know he got DQ'd. Did you just get DQ'd in that moto or for the whole day?
Yeah, DQ'd just in that moto. So like he was completely white from the timing and scoring sheets, everything. Just in that moto. Avery, to that point too, like I get where everybody's trying to, you know, get content and hype and all that out there going, but like, dude, this is one of those things where until you see it, you can't really go like, oh my God, because a lot of people on the internet that have been talking shit.
YouTube clip.
They're in the comments right now on everybody's, on Barcia's thing, like, oh my God, dude, you're so sick. That's how racing is. And it's like, bro, I just saw you 12 hours ago talking the most hardcore shit about him. Like,
yeah.
We know the screen names, bud. Like, we all know it.
Yeah. Yep.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
What did Will say about it? We had Will Hahn in our office this morning.
He didn't talk about it. He said, I haven't seen it.
Yeah, he acted like he had no idea what was going on.
Will's very, very neutral when it comes to that, the whole Barcia aggro.
Yeah. I mean, Will has a tough job right now. I mean, yeah, he's a trainer. Like, he's got a huge part, you know, and he's good friends with Barcia. You know what I mean? Yeah. That's what he has to do. He has to have the riders back in his, you know, in his situation, and that might not always be the easiest thing to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, and especially whenever you have guys like, you know, like Moseman, who's had an up and down year, you know, with crashes, and then every time on the broadcast they go to Pierce Brown, he's on the ground. So, you know, especially with like the whole Jet and Moseman thing, with Jet giving him thumbs up after he just crashes, you know, right there after the finish. I don't know. I feel like Will has to juggle a lot, you know. Mm-hmm. And
it's not a well-liked semi right now.
Yeah. It's not. I think he's doing a good job at juggling that, you know, because, I mean, Will is one of the most liked guys in the pits.
Totally.
You know, and I don't think, you know, he's got one of the most hated riders in on the team. So it's kind of hard.
Yeah, what I
said. On that point, Chase, about like what trucks aren't liked in the pits right now, some of the hardcore dick riding and then the complete opposites that fans will have from one week to the next, like, oh my God, Star's the greatest team ever. I can't wait to do everything that I can to be a Star fanboy. And then they do a couple things. Oh my God, I hate that team now.
Yep,
it's like,
yep.
Dude, do you not watch any other sports? Like, they all go through it. It's a business. They're all, if you watch it long enough, you're going to see the same things happen over and over and over again.
Yep.
You know?
Yeah. Hey, what about the Spanish kid?
Dude, badass.
Dude, that kid was good.
I had him on my fantasy team. He did really good.
How'd he do? 100?
It was close. I mean, what did he get?
What was his handicap?
7-12? I think he was a 12 handicap.
Ooh, that's good, dude.
You guys are nerds.
I don't play, but man, that's pretty solid.
Dude, I enjoyed his interview you did, Anton. He speaks English quite well.
Yeah, he does. How about that he goes, I don't ride a Yamaha. I've only ridden the bike 6 times. Yeah. So. I was just like, are you serious, bro?
Dude.
Like, that's unbelievable.
And how old is he? He's young, too, yeah?
He's young, yeah.
15 or 16, I think.
I think he's like 17. He's old enough. Like, yeah, he's not like straight little kid.
Yeah.
But, yeah, he lives just outside Barcelona. We talked quite a bit after that interview was over. And I was like, so how did this all come together? And he goes, well, they had heard that I'm pretty good, and I'm just kind of trying to figure out stuff for Europe right now. And I'm like, okay. And he's like, so they flew me over, and I tested the bike. And you know, we had heard a rumor a couple weeks ago that, you know, Star shut down the place. Nobody was allowed to be there. The Spanish guy's testing. And so many people thought it was Prado.
Yeah.
It's this kid.
Yeah.
And, you know, he had only ridden the bike a couple times, and then as the week was going on, the team was talking to him, and they're like, well, do you want to stay and race this weekend? And they're like, maybe. I guess I can. And then after Bud's Creek was over, they're like, well, you're going to stay one more week, and you're going to race Ironman now, too.
Oh, yeah.
And so he's the MX2 rider for Team Spain this year.
Wow.
And then even after it was over, I'm like, so will you do that with Star? And I don't know. He's still trying to figure that out. So he's kind of
– I like how his answer was, why not?
Purgatory sentence.
Yeah,
I mean, I don't think he would mind, you know, riding the Star bike a little bit more, right?
Like, yeah, yeah, I'm sure he's fine with it.
Like in Europe, compared to, you know, his bike or the Star bike here, right?
Yeah,
yeah. So was he? You said both. Is he an MX2 guy or EMX?
He's EMX predominantly, but he's lined up for a few MX2 models this year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
So this is like full on tryout, right? This isn't just a. He was there prior to Romano getting hurt, is what I'm trying to say, right?
Yeah.
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 Okay.
He was, he's been here for a little bit trying to get all of that sorted out to figure out what they're going to do. And then he doesn't know when he's leaving. You know, he's like, I could stay another week. I could stay three more weeks. I could go home right away. I have no idea.
Yeah.
I'd like to see how he does on a supercross track. I think that's the big thing. Because I had said this after Unadilla. If somebody like the Gilbert guy from the UK that rides the 450, if a couple of these dudes that could ride moto really, really well had supercross skills, there's a lot of hidden talent over there that we just haven't noticed in a while.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, we got to talk about Justin Cooper getting the MX2 slot.
Yeah, we do.
What was the mood like in the pits, in the star pits specifically?
I didn't go to the star pit, so I can't say for sure. But Justin was sick, and he even said, you know, it sounded like he was sick after Unadilla, so he kept a pretty low profile. The AMA guy, I talked to Mike Pelletier, you know, the AMA guys knew that this was going to be a big decision, and they figured that Christian would be, you know, understandably frustrated by the outcome of it, but they hope to talk to him because they would like to have him as a retainer, you know, in case they do need him for something. And that just kind of builds that dynamic of the inclusivity and the build the morale, have every base covered so that when we do go to Red Bud, or when they do go to Red Bud, it's not like a fire drill. Everybody's on the same page. Everybody's working the way that they need to, and hopefully they win for their sake, because like they're doing everything they can this year to make sure that they win.
Yeah.
You know,
God, how long has it been since USA's won?
I don't know. Before I started watching Motocross the Nations, before I knew it was, it's crazy.
Well, when was it?
I can't even remember.
11 years?
Italy? It's been a while.
Who was on the team?
I think the last Des Nations I went to was Italy, and it was Stu Farian.
Oh, wow.
It was a while. It's been a while.
Wow.
It was on Stu's undefeated year.
Hmm.
Because that was the only moto he lost because he landed on a hay bale. But, yeah.
Hold on, Chase. I'll tell you. Last year, 2011, was the last year the Team USA won. It was at Saint-Jean in France. And that was Dungey, Baggett, and Villopoto.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, wow. that was when Villopoto and Dungey were, like, hugging each other after the race. And I was like, whoa, that's weird. Wow. So,
hey, that French team is good. That French team is really good. I don't know if we talked about that much last week, but that is a solid group. With
there's
Marvin
some good
dropping
teams.
Out of the 250. Yeah.
That's a good team. Australia is going to be good.
Dude. Marv on a 250 is going to be badass.
Yeah.
We saw him riding a 250 a while ago.
Yeah, that day at Glen Helen, he was ripping on that thing.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, so Cooper was sick.
Right, a couple journalists in the sport, I think Talking Boy and maybe it was Mathis, someone else, said he had COVID, right? He tested positive on Monday. So, I don't know. I'm interested to see because I have friends who are fitter than me and they took like a month and a half to recover from COVID, right? So, I'm interested to see how he does these next 2 weeks.
Depends which one he had.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because if he's not riding during the week to get better, then yeah. I guess we'll see, but
I don't know because you had that. What was the latest?
I don't know
flavor they had. Omicron.
Yeah,
like that was nothing. I had that. And I was like, whatever. But I don't know. It's nice to see that it's finally settled though, and all put together.
Mm-hmm. I was kind of surprised. I thought they were gonna announce like four guys. That's what I had heard earlier in the week. So, I'm wondering how Christian feels about it. The whole scenario.
Yeah, no, he didn't address
it. A little bummed. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Hey, what happened? Did RJ Hampshire didn't come to the press tent after the race?
Yeah, he didn't. He did the
press conference.
Press conference, yeah, but he didn't come over there. Husky's not really done it a lot. Like, Dino came to the one after Unadilla, but there haven't been a lot of Husky guys over at it this year. Like, Jalik might have come over. At one or two, but I haven't seen them at it all the time. But do great for RJ after the first moto, man. He was really stoked on running that scoop tire. He was very happy about his decision to use that. Even under that, the cool down tent, he just kept looking at it and telling the team, like, man, I'm glad we did that.
This is like the year of the scoop tire. Jeez.
Yeah.
Because the track looked pretty hard pack, right?
Yeah, it was.
No, it looked like it had a hard base to it.
Yeah.
And then I think I heard on the I think Steve's post race. They had some engine stuff or something in his, on his bike that they had made a change. I guess. Jonas is over here, the main guy from Europe.
Yeah.
Is what you're saying. So he's been asking for it, and I think they got him some good parts, and I think that, I mean, he was really, I don't know, it seemed like he was really happy with the bike, a lot more happy than he has been.
Yeah, good for him, though. Got a win in each this year.
Yeah.
Supercross.
Oh, hey, while we're on the KTM note, Tony was only going to do Saturday.
Right.
Like, that was it. He wasn't going to do any more races, and then it was unfortunate because he had a really, really rough day.
Yeah.
He was in the cool down area with a like soft cast on his arm. I didn't get a chance to talk to him. He had dipped out before that. But I had talked to Jill like early in the day, and she's like, oh yeah, we only came over for 4 days. Like, we flew in, we're gonna do this race, we're flying back home. They didn't even bring the kid with them. They're just trying to go that fast.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there was a lot of wondering if he was gonna do Ironman and keep staying, but no, they were only gonna be here for the weekend.
So he's doing all of his prep out there then for Disney Nations, I'd assume.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What else? I think the scoop.
Yeah, he doesn't have very good luck at Bud's Creek. You know, I mean, hell, he was there what 15 years ago, and he still wasn't very good.
When RV smoked everyone on 250. I remember that. Ooh. That was a great day. Actually, no, that was the last one I went to.
Okay.
But switching channels though, Monster Mountain. I think that scoop tire would have worked great there.
Yeah, probably.
But
I think a different airline would have been great too.
Yeah. Yeah. American Airlines, you can eat my butt. But yeah, we had the 7MX Mini Major East this weekend out at Monster Mountain. Two great days of racing. I posted about my Instagram. I really enjoyed seeing the reads there. Like, cuz Chad chose the Mini Major last year to bring his kids to as their first big race, right? I think, or their first race ever.
Was it?
Yeah, wow. It was. And they're like, obviously, if you follow them on social media or YouTube, they're fully invested in it, and they race everywhere. I think Ellie told me they had like 9 bikes or something.
Jesus.
And I think Pace did 4 classes, Tate did 3, and Kaya did 2. But it seemed like Chad was at the starting line every time I looked down there.
That or washing bikes, yeah.
Yeah, washing bikes or packing gates. And I don't know. It's just awesome to see that. And what investment they've made into amateur racing.
Yeah.
But, I don't know. I didn't see – there was no Drew Adams type kid this year.
Yeah, there is no, let's see, amateur factory-supported riders or so that. But there were quite a few, like – low-key fast kids who were straight off of Loretta's, like still had Loretta's backgrounds on their plates and stuff, and mm-hmm. just dads were like, yeah, we're gonna keep racing. Like, a lot of kids, they're taking breaks right now, but yeah, we had a couple super mini kids that were just fresh off of good results at Loretta's and like kept the momentum going.
Yeah, the kid that won super mini 3, mm-hmm. he only rode super mini 3, he didn't ride the other one or two.
Is that the fast house kid?
He rode a FXR.
FXR kid, okay. Yeah.
He had the Cooper Webb Bell helmet on.
Yes, yes.
But I was really impressed by that kid on the 65 that was in the Thor gear.
That kid was on it. So I'm forgetting his name, but he's pretty well known. Like, I'd say that was maybe one of the kids with the biggest name, I guess, so to say. Dennis Block at 7 knew, was well aware of who the kid was.
Yeah, he's the one who pointed it out to me.
Yeah, I don't think he lost a moto all weekend. Mm-hmm. He was on it.
But yeah, I don't know. It was pretty cool. We got a big rainstorm Saturday night, and Keith at Monster Mountain did a great job with his crew of cleaning it up.
Mm-hmm.
I think even it was surprisingly not that bad. Like, even in the infield and stuff, when we walked around, I didn't like almost eat shit in the mud.
Yeah.
Or anything, but man, it's a different world back there, Alabama.
It is.
It's Dennis Block. He said it right. He goes, man, it's like I'm at Chick-fil-A. Everyone is so nice. So
yeah,
happy.
Yeah.
But I don't know. It was pretty good. But yeah, we had some nightmares in our travel. All 4 legs of our trip there and back were bad.
Yep.
We ended up having to drive 2.5 hours to Atlanta to get home. And somehow we got home last night by midnight. Did you get home by midnight?
Wow. No, a little past, but it's okay.
Yeah. But I was asleep by midnight. It was good. But I don't know. I don't think we'll be flying into Montgomery next time.
Nope. Nope.
No. I didn't see your neighbor there, eh, Ray? The guy that bought your track.
You did?
I didn't. Well, I'm assuming he would have come running up to me and said something to me about you. There was a couple people that said...
His kid won, like, 3 classes.
Oh, really?
Huh.
Yeah, they posted something on Instagram. Brent Brush, his dad.
Yeah.
They told me, they're like, hey, man, we ain't missing these Swapmoto races, mini majors. They love them.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's awesome.
Nice. I had quite a few people come up to me and say, hey, what's A-Ray doing next year and all that.
But yeah.
a lot of people commented that they like you hosting the SML show.
Yeah, I'm telling you what. Like, I mean, yes, I have been on the East Coast for quite some time now, but I am missing it. Like, I was thinking about it honestly today. Like, I like doing those shows. I like doing this show. It's tough sometimes with all of our schedules being different, but this is something that I love to do. It's awesome.
Mm-hmm. And we can't talk about next year. A-Ray racing next year. But yeah, wheels are turning here. Wheels are turning.
Yep.
So, I guess with that we wrap
up. Shout out to the PW kid.
Who?
That kid made my weekend. There's PW a kid I thought on Saturday. There's a kid I thought was stuck under his bike and no one was coming. So I dropped my camera. I ran out to him, and I picked up his bike. And I'm like, "You all right, buddy?" He's like, "Yeah, I just don't want to ride."
So I
took his bike off the track, and he just sat there on his bike and was looking and waited for the checkered flag, and then I saw him just ride back into the pits.
Nice. Yeah. I cleaned out a female.
Oh yeah.
Stasic Grom Cross rider.
There was
a kid. There's a Chinese kid that didn't speak English.
Are you sure he was Chinese?
Dude, I know he was Chinese because I heard his dad talking to him, like, bong, 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 whatever. But I do know this word in Chinese is jai-ho or jai-ho or something. It means, like, go for it. Mm. And I heard the dad yelling, jai-ho, jai-ho, as the kid went by. But so this kid won the moto, and I was filming the Grom Cross with the GoPro because the stabilization's great. And I'm, like, walking up the finish line behind him. And I hear this dad go, "Watch out, watch out." And I'm like off the track. And some little girl just plows into the back of my left calf on her Stasic. And nothing happened to me, but she ate shit. Was crying. I thought I was going to get harassed for taking out a kid. But I was off the track. She hit me.
Mm-hmm. You can tell a lot of kids back east do off-road riding a lot because I had 2 kids crash into me off the track as well. Shout out to the kid that burnt my calf with his pipe.
Yeah. Nice. Anyway, so that's it for this week's show. Shout out to my buddy Wayne at Polar, who listens to every show and always sends me screenshots of his watch with our show on it in various places, like the beach or the lake or something.
Cool.
Anyway, we'll talk to you. What?
Oh, I was going to say Wayne's awesome.
Yeah, he's awesome.
You know, he's been helping me out for years. Honestly,
yeah, you've been a Polar guy forever.
All my Polar stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Of course.
Yep.
Great stuff.
So, anyway, guys, thanks for listening, and we'll talk to you next Monday after Ironman MX. And, man, let's all keep our fingers crossed for some amazing racing going into Indiana.
Yeah.
All right. Talk to you next week. Since 1991, Pro Taper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8 inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, Pro Taper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit protaper.com for more.